Well, I mean, I don't think, at least at my level, we're not talking about carbon credits and things like that, but the use of tax incentives is certainly not a new idea. It's used every day to incentivize businesses to come here and make investment in the states, and all states do that. And so if there's a way to incentivize placement of funds, whether those funds come from the private sector or from the public at large, from communities, whatever, into some sort of a fund that would promote and pay for environmental restoration, I think that's a fine idea. I mean, I don't know exactly how you would set that kind of thing up, but in concept, it's right in line with what the states do all the time in the business community.
One of the things we have done in Mississippi a lot, and I told Judy I was going to embarrass her by bragging on her, but I think that the Land Trust for the Coastal Plain has done a lot of work in doing protection and land conservation and working to gain easements as well. So many of the resiliency strategies we're talking about, I think, could be achieved by encouraging that sort of donation and reaching out to landowners and educating about that, like organizations like GD have done. So I think that's been one thing that we as a state have been real successful in.
Also, as Susan mentioned earlier, the high-risk areas, Susan and y'all have already mapped, which also, in many cases, overlap or at least include a lot of the areas when you look at the slant wildlife where you have need to allow those wetlands to migrate in. If we could look at, if the agencies could begin looking at their wetland mitigation policies as a means of possibly allowing, as a means of mitigation when it's needed, that mitigation could occur through conservation of lands in those high hazard areas. For twofold reason. One is conservation of the high hazard area to make the area more sustainable, more resilient, but then also to allow for those wetlands in those areas to not be unavailable in the future because some development is done there.
I'd like to run by for a second just some of the policy changes that have been suggested in some of the forums at the federal level and see if it spurs any thoughts, if you agree, if you disagree, if you see problems with them or whatever. Create an apparatus or single agency through executive order or statute to plan and manage implementation of projects to restore and protect the Gulf Coast region. The federal government needs to move away from an agency-by-agency and statute-by-statute decision-making process and develop a comprehensive approach. There are many ways to skin that cat, and I think they're all being looked at. Yes?
Hi, my name is Tracy
Simpier.
I'm with the Mississippi Alabama Sea Grant Consortium. And I think that just sort of move back into, I guess, my comments are more priority about built environment. So when I say I work with communities, I'm talking about like a global government level. And so we currently have some climate adaptation planning efforts going on in some of our local communities, one in each of our three coastal counties in Mississippi. And for me, when I look at this, to me that's a big priority, and there's some gaps that we're missing. So what we're trying to do is similar to what was mentioned in the funding earlier about leveraging dollars, so we have very minimal dollars that we can help to work with the communities, but we're leveraging that with some of the hazard mitigation funds that they're getting for updating their hazard mitigation plans. Currently, communities are not required to incorporate things like sea level rise into their hazard mitigation plans, nor do we have sea level rise on our digital flood insurance rate maps from FEMA. And so to me, I'm trying to figure out once we get the communities through this planning stage, which is great, they're all agreeing to, you know, plan to plan and to get a plan in place. It's going to be an interesting battle of political will to actually implement some of the great ideas that are coming out of this and some of the, you know, how do we use this as a decision maker.
I just wanted to address a couple of things, even though I haven't been here for the 2 days. The coastal ecology and restoration is very important to all of us, and we're all here for the same reason. But there's a couple of things that have been concerning me lately, and that partially involves the EPA. They've been coming under a lot of investigation lately, And I hope that each of you will consider having a backup plan to the EPA for, as American citizens, that we make sure that we keep our ecology and restoration an American thing instead of an international issue. We know that the EPA has been is closely linked to the United Nations, and I would like to submit a couple of a letter from Senator James Inhofe. He's a Republican from Oklahoma, who has called for a new investigation into the EPA. And I have a letter here to Barbara Boxer, because the Inspector General of the EPA has found the EPA guilty of inappropriate conduct, and that's probably not the legal term, but for falsifying their scientific data concerning climate change and carbon dioxide. The EPA endangerment findings rests in large measure on the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, report and conclusions, as based on the Administrator Jackson's own testimony before the committee. Yet, despite the fact that the IPCC's credibility has been repeatedly called into question, the IG report shows that the EPA blindly accepted its conclusions without considering the independent assessment, as the EPA is preparing to enact policies that will cost trillions of dollars and millions of jobs. It is unconstitutional that the agency would short-circuit its own peer review process and substitute the view of the international body in place of its own. Regardless of what one thinks of the IPCC, the EPA IG found the EPA is still required by its own procedures to conduct an independent review before moving forward. If I may submit that for your consideration, who do I submit that to officially?
I just wanted to clarify the Inspector General's report. You know, essentially there's some procedures, I understand, the EPA has to go through if they're issuing a significant scientific report, and there's a dispute and interpretation between whether the endangerment finding that EPA came up with was a significant scientific report as opposed to their EPA's interpretation, which said that we're citing existing science that's out there. And so I believe it's been misconstrued what EPA has done and what the Inspector General's findings are. It's yet to get worked out.
I think that it's our responsibility as citizens of the United States of America and of the Gulf Coast concerned about the ecology, that we look into the position of the EPA and its relationship to the United Nations, and whether or not we want the United Nations regulating the United States, or whether we want our local government and our local states telling us how we are going to regulate our own wetlands, Gulf Coast area. And so then furthermore, I'd like to submit a document concerning how the United Nations has been influencing our domestic policy and using very clever terms like sustainable development, sustainability, climate commitment, biodiversity. And I hope that you will take into consideration what NASA scientists and independent scientists have even come up this year with, that carbon dioxide is not a poisonous gas that needs to be regulated. and that the scientific findings were based on false science, that carbon dioxide does not cause global warming, that right now, according to John Casey, who's a former NASA scientist, out of Florida.
These are all very, and we appreciate and we'll be glad to accept your document. Those are very controversial, back and forth. I mean, frankly, probably among our group, we have a number of prospective scientists. We understand there's a dispute, but what we're saying is we're going to see impacts regardless. Even if we don't believe in humanity's climate change, their leaks, their risks, and sustainability, that's probably what we're focusing on today. So we will be glad to accept your information and take your opinion under advisement. But I don't want to get into it. Do we believe in climate change and which scientists is more reputable today?
Okay, I appreciate that. And I ask that you consider the latest scientific data, as we all do, and consider all the science that's available to us, whether you consider it true or false, that you consider it all. I ask that you make a copy of all these documents that I've submitted today, and that you present that to make a copy available to everybody here, as you're going to make copies of this, and that you also put it online with your documentation, please. Can you, will you be willing to put it online with your documentation as a submission of a private citizen?
I think in the context of what's been discussed here, you know, that could be part of the record.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, Karen.
Yes, I just want to, as always, we've had some very interesting discussions. Thank you. And appreciate everyone staying for the duration of the meeting. Again, I know you all have incredible schedules, but this is incredibly important. I think it's very helpful to this group as we try to represent different voices in terms of what needs to be done from the voices in the community in terms of influencing resiliency as we move forward. So again, we'll be putting this, as Cindy said, the results of this meeting, and this will be wrapped up, I guess, in a series of bigger recommendations with the voices. Your role in this is incredibly important. I'll just say thank you and the remainder of the day.
Yes, and I too want to just reiterate our appreciation of your time and your interest and your energy. Please feel free at any point to contact us to submit any other thoughts and recommendations you may